Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Abu Zar Ghaffari. I am demonstrator at Pharmacology Department here at MDC. And we are studying today the topic of sulfonamides, trimethoprim and fluoroquinolones. These are basically antibiotics. We'll divide them in two groups, sulfonamides and trimethoprim, and then the other group is fluoroquinolones. Okay, the sulfonamides and trimethoprim, they are anti-metabolites. They are selectively toxic to the microorganisms because they are interfering with their DNA synthesis and particularly the folic acid synthesis. Their combination will sequentially block the folic acid synthesis, hence blocking the DNA synthesis. And fluoroquinolones, the second group, they selectively inhibit the nucleic acid metabolism, and both of these groups are broad spectrum, covering the gram negative and gram positive organisms. Moving on to the classification of sulfonamides, trimethoprim and fluoroquinolones. First group is anti-metabolites, which include obviously the sulfonamides and trimethoprim and their combination. Second group is fluoroquinolones. They have two types of spectrums, narrow spectrum and wide spectrum. In the narrow spectrum fall first generation norfloxacin, and under the wide spectrum drugs there are two generations, second generation and third generation. Second generation includes commonly used drug ciprofloxacin, and third generation includes levofloxacin. Next is the mechanism of action of antimetabolites. So we have PABA, para-aminobenzoic acid, which is used in the synthesis of DNA. And this PABA is inhibited by the sulfonamides because they inhibit the enzyme involved in the synthesis of this structure. Next is formed dihydrofolic acid, if it is sequencing in a normal manner, dihydrofolic acid is formed, and from the dihydrofolic acid, tetrahydrofolic acid will be formed, which is basically formed by the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase. That enzyme is inhibited by the trimethoprim drug. So we are sequentially blocking the synthesis of DNA, basically the synthesis of folic acid or tetrahydrofolic acid, by first adding the sulfonamides and then adding the trimethoprim. So their combination will enhance their effect and block the synthesis of DNA in the bacteria. Clinical uses of sulfonamides: they are active against both gram-positive and gram-negative organisms and chlamydia and nocardia. They are used in certain conditions, for example, simple UTIs, and used is used in oral form. Next is ocular infections or eye infections, used as eye drops. In burn infections, it is used as topical ointment or topical cream. And next is ulcerative colitis and rheumatoid arthritis. In both of these conditions, it is used orally. Lastly, in toxoplasmosis, oral sulfadiazine plus pyrimethamine, which is an other dihydrofolate acid, dihydrofolate reductase inhibitor, it is used in toxoplasmosis. Next are the uses of trimethoprim and sulfimethoxazole, the combination of both of these drugs we discussed. This combination is effective orally in the treatment of UTIs and in respiratory, ear or sinus infections. This combination is the drug of choice for prevention and treatment of pneumocystis pneumonia, which is caused by pneumocystis jarovici. Lastly, IV formulation is available for patients who are unable to use drug by mouth and is used in the treatment of the same conditions we discussed above. It is also a drug of choice in nocardiosis. Here we see the toxicities of sulfonamides and trimethoprim acts more likely in the same manner with regards to the toxicities. And this includes most commonly hypersensitivity reactions and GIT disturbance. In hematotoxicity component, it causes acute hemolysis in the patients of G6PD deficiency. Next is nephrotoxicity. It commonly precipitates the urine at acidic pH, causing crystalluria and hematuria. And in the drug interactions section, it can displace bilirubin from plasma proteins. Hence, it can cause Kernig terrace or the brain condition due to increased bilirubin levels. In the neonate, if used in third trimester of the pregnancy in pregnant women. Hence, it is contraindicated in pregnant women. Next is the fluoroquinolones group. Its mechanism of action is the same bigger heading is the it interferes with the bacterial DNA synthesis, just like the sulfonamides and trimethoprim, but by a different mechanism, which is by inhibiting topoisomerase 2, also called DNA gyrase, especially in gram-negative organisms, and topoisomerase 4 in gram-positive organisms. It uses urogenital and GAD infections, which are caused by gram-negative organisms, also used in respiratory tract, skin, and soft tissue infections. Now, the gemcitabine and moxifloxacin, which are also considered as the fourth generation fluoroquinolones, are newer drugs of fluoroquinolones group. They have the widest spectrum of activity and hence active against both gram positive and gram negative organisms, as well as anaerobic bacteria and certain atypical pneumonia agents. Toxicity includes GIT distress, which is the most common adverse effect. Next are skin rashes, headache, dizziness, insomnia. These can occur rarely. Opportunistic infection is very common in a prolonged or chronic use of fluoroquinolones, and this opportunistic infection is caused by Candida albicans and Streptococci. Fluoroquinolones, they are not recommended for children and pregnant women because they can damage the growing cartilage and they can cause arthropathy in both of these patients' age groups. Newer fluoroquinolones, they prolong the QT interval, hence they are contraindicated in patients with having arrhythmias or when a patient is already receiving a drug which is prolonging the QT interval. Here is your assignment. If you have any question, please comment. Thank you.